Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. This book review is going to be about one of my favorite books from my childhood, A Wreath for Emmett Till. It was written by Marilyn Nelson and it was illustrated by Felipe Lardi. This book is a heroic crown of sonnets, which is basically interlinked sonnets about the Emmett Till case. So I will explain the book first, just to get to the review if you know about the Emmett Till case, and then I will get to the actual case if you do not know the case. So as far as this book goes, I feel it's a good book for all ages, but some people might disagree. There aren't any pictures that are too scary in this book. The scariest picture that I can think of in this book are ones with crows. Yeah. Emmett Till and a wreath of thorns, a crown of thorns, and some ravens or some crows. But if you're worried about like images of gore and blood, you won't get that. You might get like red to represent blood, but you won't get that if you're reading this to a child. There are also notes in the back about each sonnet that explains what each sonnet meant and where she got the information and all of that, the author. There's also an artist note in the back as well. The way heroic crowns of sonnets work are, I don't know if she wrote this in iambic pentameter, but the last line of the first sonnet becomes the first line of the next sonnet. So she has a total of like 14 or 15 sonnets going through the life of Emmett Till. Marilyn Nelson uses the language of flowers, dendrochronology, I think it's dendrochronology, to speak about the case. So she'll use mandrake root, she'll use rosemary and all of that, and describes their meanings, their metaphorical, historical meanings, and incorporates all of these flowers and plants into a wreath for Emmett Till, like a laurel, an honorary wreath in his memory. So she uses, I'm like looking at the book. So she uses the Italian and Petrarchan rhyme scheme, which on average goes like ABBA, ABBA, CDE, CDE. And sometimes you can vary it, but essentially that's what it is. ABBA, ABBA, CDE, CDE. That's the rhyme scheme. Okay, so now I will tell you about the case and my personal experience with the Emmett Till case and incorporate it with the book as I go along. So I learned about the Emmett Till case when I was 14 years old. Emmett Till was 14 years old when he was lynched. Emmett Till was an only child. I'm an only child. So it was weird. I kind of had like this personal connection with Emmett Till. I just don't know why. So after learning about the Emmett Till case, I became obsessed with the Emmett Till case. I'm still obsessed with the Emmett Till case. And this might relate to my obsession with reading about lynchings and everything. So I bought this book. I have his mother's book, which I read. I have Emmett Till, The Lynching of Emmett Till, a documentary narrative, which I've read. I've seen documentaries about him. I read articles about this case. I went and I saw a play and I had the people sign the book at Harris Stowe. Yeah. It was The Face of Emmett Till. So I was pretty much very obsessed with the case. So the story of Emmett Till, if you do not know it, Emmett Till was 14 years old. 14-year-old black boy, only child of Mamie and his father, Louis Till. He was 14 years old from Chicago, 1955, he went on vacation to Money, Mississippi to go visit his relatives because his mother felt like he needed to spend time, be a boy, spend time out in the country, you know, have fun with your cousins, hang out with your uncle. And she warned him before he left. She's like, Emmett, the white people down there are not like the white people in Chicago, even though there's racism everywhere. But she's like, Emmett, like, even if you have to beg and kiss their feet on the ground, please don't get into any trouble. Like, just be on your best behavior. Like, she basically drilled him before he went off to the South. And he's like, oh, okay, Mom, okay. Sent him off on the train to go to Money, Mississippi. So things were pretty much okay when he was there, essentially, initially. But then something happened. The apparent wolf whistle. Now there's controversy about if he even whistled at all. So did he wolf whistle or did he not whistle? His mother said that he had a stuttering problem. I believe he got it from, I want to say he had polio, which left him with a speech impediment, but don't quote me on that. But he did have a stuttering issue. So his mother told him to whistle to get his words out. So he went into the store, Bryant's store, to go get something, I suppose. So some cases said he whistled outside. Some people said he whistled in the store. I don't know. Nobody knows. But apparently he wolf whistled at Carolyn Bryant, who was this white woman. Her husband and her husband's brother were out of town. So, yeah. They were somewhere else. So, who knows? Story spread. There's like, I can't give you an exact facts because there's so many differing opinions. But the story spread and it somehow got to the husband's. So, long story short, Emmett Till was at his Uncle Moses' house. Called him Mose. His name was Moses. They called him Preacher because that's basically what he was, Preacher. Or that was his nickname. Emmett Till was kidnapped from his uncle's house. Kidnapped at gunpoint. He was going to put on his shoes. But they're like, you won't need shoes where you're going. So, nobody knows how many people were involved. Some say it was like all white. Some say it was a mixture of black and white. But whatever happened to Emmett Till, he never came back alive. He was taken from his uncle's house and was cruelly tortured. And his body was thrown in the Tallahatchie River. It was tied with barbed wire to a cotton gin fan thrown in the Tallahatchie River. But he floated up to the top of the river after 3 days because they didn't tie down his feet. So when they found his body, he was bloodied and bruised. I don't think he was wearing any clothes. One of his eyes was missing. His eyes was gouged out. His teeth, everything was just really messed up. His face, nobody could tell who he was except could kind of tell by the hair that it was probably a black person because of the hair texture. But he was fished out by this boy. The only way they identified him was because of a ring on his finger that belonged to his father, Lewis, who had died around the time he was 3 or 4. So before Emmett went to Money, Mississippi, the ring fit because it didn't used to fit. He used to have to tape it. It had his father's initials on it, and that's how they identified him. So they wanted to bury him in Mississippi because his body was just deteriorating so fast. They were talking about like the stench of the body and everything. But he was sent back to Chicago. He was packed in 2 boxes. One box had lime, and the mother didn't find that out until they like looked at his body. So there's a train. His body goes back to the train to Chicago. His mother's having a nervous breakdown because that's her only child, and here's his big box. And so she had to be carried. Like, she was having a whole meltdown. So if you want to see, like, photographs of, like, his body coming back from Mississippi to Chicago, there's photographs of that online. So the mother, Mamie, she had an open casket funeral because she wanted to show the world what had been done to her son. Now, lynchings back then, nobody really put it, like, in the paper. Like, well, they did put it in the paper, but it was basically, like, lynching photographs of, like, oh, this is, look, I killed somebody today, and it's people sending off postcards. Like, images that you can see in Without Sanctuary. But this one was different. It was, like, full body story. It gave the lynching victim life. So the most famous photograph of Emmett Till was seen in Jet Magazine. So if you want to look up Jet Magazine's images of him, you can look that up online as well, or in a book. So there was an outroar about this, and his death was one of the things that sparked the civil rights movement. A lot of people became afraid, especially young people, because they're like, if this can happen to Emmett Till, this can happen to me. I'm 14, I'm 11. The youngest lynching victim I've ever read about was Mary Turner's baby, who was an 8-month-old fetus. So they cut the baby out of her womb. And yeah, that was a whole nother story. I'll get into that later. But yes. So Emmett Till's lynchers were taken to trial, and of course, it was judged by an all-white jury, and they weren't sentenced. Carolyn Bryant, I believe, is still alive, but she lied on the stand, so she should have been arrested for perjury anyway, because if you read the court documents, it's like, look, you're freaking lying, lady, but whatever. It was a very big deal, because they were trying to sexualize Emmett Till, how they sexualized a lot of black men back then. Because a lot of black men and black boys were lynched because of rape. But what was rape? Some men were lynched because they said good morning. One man was lynched because he brushed up against a white woman on accident. One man was lynched because they couldn't find anybody. They couldn't find the person who apparently did the crime, so they just found a random black person and lynched them. Like, it didn't matter how old you were, it didn't matter if you were a child, it didn't matter if you were a woman, it didn't matter if you were a fetus, it did not matter. They would take you from your home, they'd arrest you, put you in jail, break into jail, and lynch you. So Emmett Till's story was just a story and a bunch of stories. So because of that Emmett Till case in the collective consciousness, a lot of people thought he was castrated, which is what happened to a lot of black men that were lynched. His mother said he was not castrated. His eye was gouged out, one of his eyes. She recognized one of the eyes because it was hazel. When he was born, she kind of panicked because his hair was blonde-ish and his eyes were basically blue. So she's like, oh my god. But yes, it was her only child. She never had any more children. She spent the rest of her life keeping her son's memory alive and being an activist in the community and fighting against injustice. So if you would like to read more about Emmett Till, if you would like to read more about just lynchings in general, I'll give you some titles. One of the best books you can read on lynching is 100 Years of Lynching by Ralph Ginsberg. It's just straight newspaper articles about lynching. There's no, like, commentary. It's just straight newspaper articles about lynching. There's also Without Sanctuary. I actually think 100 Years of Lynching is scarier than Without Sanctuary, because 100 Years of Lynching has, like, all the descriptions. It's, like, terrifying. If you're prone to nightmares, you will have nightmares. Without Sanctuary is just a book of a collection of postcards that the people who lynched black people made of their lynch victims, and they would send the postcards off to families. So you had children in the postcards, you had babies, you had preachers, you had people from all walks of life that were white, of course, and black people that were in there. I still don't know why black people were there, because I would not be there. In the postcards. And they would send them off to relatives. Emmett Till, The Lynching of Emmett Till, a documentary narrative, is a good one. Emmett Till's mother's book, which is called The Death of Innocence, and At the Hands of Persons Unknown, which is about lynching. There's a documentary about Emmett Till, and I cannot remember what it is called. It's by Keith Beauchamp. No, maybe that's... Is it Keith Beauchamp? I don't know. But yes, there are also some new books that have come out about Emmett Till that I have yet to read, but I'm definitely about to read them. So I hope you learned a lot today. If you want to read more by Marilyn Nelson, she has a book called Carver, A Life in Poems, which is excellent. She also has one called Fortune's Bones, which is about an enslaved man that was made into a skeleton after his death. And the family doctor used his skeleton as an example. It's just really creepy. So, thank you for watching this video. And I would recommend this for teachers, for people wanting to learn about Black history, for young people, for people of various backgrounds. I recommend Aretha Armito. And I hope to see you when I make more reviews about other videos or other books. So, have a nice day and happy reading.